Good morning, good afternoon, and of course, good evening, and welcome to the UK Chinwag podcast. We've got somebody here today, somebody who is a massive part. He's modest. He will not accept any of this, I'm quite sure, so I'll say it before he gets introduced. A massive part of the UK pinball community, and I'm sure when he comes on, he'll say that he gets lots and lots of help to do what he does, and that is certainly true. But somebody that I obviously became aware of last year, you'll know from the title, you'll have seen the title, it's all about Pinfest. And it was really the highlight of my year, highlight of many people's year. It just was so well timed, I think, coming out of lockdown. And certainly the first time I've ever walked into such a venue and seen such a vast array of pinball machines. I was literally like a kid in a sweet shop. I'll bring him in now. So, Phil, as I understand it, you have just got back from Budafest and a bit of drunken debauchery.
Certainly haven't. Still feeling the effect. Got a lot of sleep to catch up on. But it was a great experience. Went, I think there was about 18 to 20 of us there. So, yes, lots of drinking, a little bit of pinball, sightseeing, more drinking, that sort of thing.
Did you all, yes. You didn't all go over on the same flight? I take it you all made your own way there and then met up once you were there, right?
Yeah, we travelled from all over the country. Myself personally, there was 11 of us travelled from Edinburgh. Some were travelling from Gatwick, places like that.
And a good all round trip, obviously, yeah?
Yeah, some of them they're enjoying the beer that much, they're still out there.
Are they really?
Some of them from the forum, yeah.
You're a bit tender today.
Yes, but it was great to see. It was a huge selection of machines, so it is well worth a visit.
Well, and old and new, I take it?
Yes. Not so much the newer ones. We were expecting to see the likes of Stern's, Godzilla, Avengers, that sort of thing, but they weren't there. I think the latest one they had was the Willy Wonka from Jersey Jack. So they didn't have a Guns N' Roses. So I think the latest was about two, three-year-old.
And they're playable. They're all playable in the museum.
Yes, obviously, like any place, there's the odd breakdown. But yeah, the majority were up and running to play.
Well, I don't think you need the new ones, actually, to be honest. If it's a museum, do you?
Exactly. I mean, there were so many old machines. It was just great to see them. Machines you never knew existed. Just getting to experience them.
Was there a standout one for you there?
Standout one? No, there wasn't a standout. Well, actually, there was one called Sexy Girl, which was an experience. I didn't know there was a pinball machine out there, which is like a PH3 pinball machine.
Oh, really?
yeah, hit certain shots, and then an image of a topless lady appears. So, yeah, that was an experience.
Oh, okay.
I never knew about that. Never knew that one existed.
My granddad used to have a pen. Like that. He used to have a pen. Yep. Do you remember?
Exactly, yeah. Pen,
and he'd turn it upside down and a leotard or whatever it would drop off. Yeah.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, he used to have quite a lot of them. Yeah, I never thought of it as a child, but now thinking about it, my nan must have been quite a liberal woman, really, because he had a key ring. Crazy. You've got a really nice collection of pins behind you, mate. Before we get on to Pinfest talk, which we must do, let's
yes.
have a chat about that, mate. What have you got there?
Yeah, well, the one closest to me is the Guns N' Roses. That's the collector's edition. I wouldn't say I was a massive Guns N' Roses fan, but I love the music. But it was just the way it was advertised by Jersey Jack, the advert when they first released it. It just had that wow factor. So yeah, that's the pride of the collection. My personal favourite next to that is the Star Trek LE. I did have a Star Trek Pro. I love it that much. I upgraded to the LE. I'll have to turn around. Sorry. Next to that is the first Avengers. Obviously, they've got the later Avengers. This was the first one that Stern released. Then we've got Batman, The Dark Knight. And next to that is Tron and then Fishtails.
Trusty old Fishtails. What do you play most out of all of them?
At the minute, admittedly, I don't play machines a lot. For me, it's more of a social thing. Except with my partner, Pauline, so we need to start playing them more. But at the minute, we're playing Guns N' Roses.
Yeah, and is it everything you thought it would be?
It is a good game. I know there's one voice out there that disagrees, but I think the rest of the voices is a really good game. And the CE is just so beautiful. It's just a beautiful looking machine.
Yeah, but it's the attention to detail, I think. And and to be fair, I think that of all of their games, I say all their games, The Wizard of Oz, certainly the... I've never seen a Pirates of the Caribbean, actually, but Wonka that you mentioned, if you look at the whatever the top level model of that is, the everlasting gobstoppers and all the things everywhere. The Hobbit looks amazing. And when I saw one of those first off, the drumsticks, the cymbals, real attention to detail, and even just it's a record that spins around, and each one of the games I think has one of the five different albums that Guns N' Roses may have done. Just the guitar nicks. You've got the Fender one and you've got the Gibson Les Paul. And the way they lock in the neck of the guitar, it's very, very innovative. And I find it a different level in terms of attention to detail.
Yes, yeah, Jersey Jack are when it comes to that sort of thing, yeah.
And I like the... one thing I say about the LE of the Star Trek on the Pro, and they're good games. You've got the same shots, but actually when it returns, I find the LE a little bit quicker because it's got the wire forms on the right ramp. When it returns round, just before it hits the flipper, it doesn't bounce. It tends to bounce, then pop back and then roll down. On the LE, it just tends to go bang. And it's just a tiny little thing, a little bit more flow to it.
I think the Star Trek LE is probably the best LE out of the DMD era. So pre-LCD screens, I think the LE is the nicest one they did.
It's always the DMDs.
But sticking with that, you don't normally ask this, but you know the favourite shots you used to talk about?
I have forgotten this, but yeah, naughty. Yeah. Come on, tell me.
It's the warp ramp on Star Trek. Not just hitting it once, it's like getting it 3-4 times in a row, just looping it and looping it and looping it. That's my favourite shot.
There's a bit of timing on there. There is a timing on that, though,
yeah,
isn't there?
Definitely, because it just gets faster and faster. Yeah. The most I've managed is 4, but it's a nice, sweet shot, that.
I know the shot. I had it here for a little while, but I had, obviously, Star Trek Next Generation here for a lot longer than that. And there's the same shot. I think it might even be... It's still called the warp ramp. I don't know. But you're certainly building up the warps on it, you know, and he's telling you, I think it's Picard, warp 1, warp 2, what, you know, and you're going up there. And as you're building it up, and for some reason, I think it gets to warp 9 or something like that. And then if I remember right, 9.1, it starts to get a bit, and you get really nervous. You're like, oh, no.
This is the same, yeah.
Yeah, brilliant game. When did you get into pinball?
Whoosh. As a kid, I was always into video arcade machines. But then once the arcades died, my kind of interest sort of waned and I lost it. But that's because I didn't know people collected them. I had a friend in Leeds. He contacted me. We used to play online, but then he started talking about arcade machines back in about 2010. And he pointed us to a forum. He says, people actually still have these arcade machines. And my mind was blown. People had like full-size video arcade machines in the houses. And then he said he had 5 pinball machines. He said, come down. Be nice to meet you. And you can play pinball all night and video arcade games. But I never really touched the video arcade games. It was the pinball I got stuck into. So was that probably about 2011. And like I say, as a kid, it was always video arcade machines, not pinball. Then the interest in pinball started in 2011. So I'm still, I still class myself as a newbie when it comes to pinball machines. So I'm trying to think what he had. He had a Revenge from Mars. There was the newer Indiana Jones. He had a Dark Knight. In fact, that's his Dark Knight that I bought from him. Can't remember the other machines he had, and that was it. The love started.
You were hooked.
Yeah, and then I found out there was retro gaming events. So it was Play Expo went along to the second one they had in Blackpool, and then the move to Manchester, and it was after the 2012 one in Manchester. I was on such a high. I thought we need something like that in the Northeast, and that's where Nerg was born.
Well, this is really, because you really, if you think, how long after you went round the fella's house, you thought, oh, this is good. How long before you decided, because obviously you've done the, to your left, obviously there's a row of arcade games there, and you've got that wonderful nostalgic Star Wars game, which is just brilliant, by the way.
Yeah.
How long after that meeting when you went round the chap's house until you bought something yourself? Be it arcade or pinball?
I'd actually bought a Jammer Cab, a Video Wizard Jammer Cab. It was located near him, so he did me the favour to pick it up. So when I went to visit him, I also picked up that cab at the same time.
So you remember that even at 2011, because we're going to hear the story now, looking at Pinfest last year, 2021 Pinfest, you've really thrown yourself in the deep end for not what. So 10 years before, I know that wasn't the first Pinfest, 10 years before that you didn't even think you could own a game.
But the first Pinfest, there was a Northern Lights pinball meet at Arcade Club in Bury. This was back in 2017, and there hadn't been a dedicated pinball event for a couple of years. I said to the Northern Lights lads, I said, well, I've been doing NERC for a few years. Why don't I organise a dedicated pinball event, and we'll bring Daventry back to life?
Let's go back to NERC. So tell us about that. Yeah. What is it? How did it come about?
Well, NERC stands for Northeast Retro Gaming. So there wasn't a retro gaming event in the Northeast. So I decided to organise the first one in 2013. So that is a mixture of video arcade, pinball, and consoles. So it's not a big, massive exhibition centre. It's in a sports hall, which is 2 5-a-side pitches. So we take up that full sports hall. And again, it's just recreating an old arcade, the few traders there, and the social side, playing games, and then drinking on an evening. There's a common theme there.
I think so.
So again, NERG has slowly grown over the years. So it's been held every year apart from the previous 2 years for obvious reasons. But it's a great formula. It works in the sports hall. It's about 800 people each day. Turn off that, 800 to 1,000 people each
day. That's a lot.
Yeah, yeah. And everything's set to free play, so they pay the admission price, and they come in and just play games all day. We've got a craft brewer there, so there's a bit of drinking again involved. And then the regulars, like Northern Lights, Scottish Pinball, a few from the forum, we all meet on an evening, Saturday evening, have a night out in Newcastle.
Well, they're a lovely bunch as well, the Scottish lot, aren't they? Had breakfast with them at Pinfest, and they were just, very, very welcoming. We'll get onto Pinfest in just a second. So you went to the Northern, so you're at the Northern Lights meet, and this is all really recent stuff. And so you noticed that there was a void in terms of, was it meant to be? Was Pinfest meant to be a national meet?
I never ever went to the previous pinball meet at Daventry. And it was just, it had been missing for 2 years. And I think the lads were hankering for someone just to put one on. There was talk in the background of trying to revive it. But I put my hand up and volunteered. I said, well, I've got experience organising NERG. And I've got my team of friends and family behind us. We could jump in and bring the pinball event back to life.
So NERG didn't put you off, because organising anything, even anybody that's even organised a stag do or even something small, is not bloody easy. Clearly, you're a glutton for punishment if you've done Budapest as well.
Everyone's on a high after the event, but then a couple of months later, you think, oh, I've got to start all over again.
Yeah. I was amazed how relaxed you were, I've got to say. I know we'll jump between everything and Pinfest constantly in this chat. I was amazed how relaxed you were. Were you like a swan, though, where you glided across the surface, but underneath you were doing that?
Well, you wouldn't be saying that if you were lying next to us in bed on a night. I've had some sleepless nights.
Well, we wouldn't have that much to drink, we would hope, anyway, Phil. You know. So it was stressful.
It's just stressful. I just have things just running through my mind, things I need to do, need to sort, that sort of thing. Just regular. It's just like a regular job. You think about your working day.
Have you got your job like that then? Have you got to organize lots of things?
I work full time as well, so I've got that. So there's the events as well.
Is running an event like your job? Is your job hectic like that? We have to bring component parts together.
No, not at all. It's totally different. I work in IT support. I tell people to switch the computer off and back on again, basically.
Have you checked the plug?
Yeah, absolutely. So that was NERG 30, 40, 50, 16, 17. So after 5 NERGs, I volunteered to do PinFest. So that was 2017, and we brought the first PinFest back to Daventry in 2018. And then we had the event in 2019, and unfortunately we missed 2020.
Did you know what to do on the first one in 2017, or was it massively a learning process? Obviously, you have a lot of help. That's evident. Did you know what you wanted to incorporate and what you wanted to do? Do you have a vision for it?
Because it is just pinball, so there wasn't the hassle of getting video arcade machines as well and consoles. So it was just strictly the pinball community. And the forum Pinball Info is 99% of reaching out and getting the support that you need there.
Yeah, absolutely.
And plus with NERG, I've got my friends and family who were behind us all the time, and they were quite happy to volunteer and come to PinFest and help out as well.
I mean, it's quite amazing. So how did that go? It must have gone well, otherwise you wouldn't have done 2018. But how was that for the first experience in 2017?
What I get out of it is just seeing people happy. I just love seeing the smiles, the laughter on the faces. And I remember it was a Saturday evening, and it was such a hot weekend, and there must have been about 60, 70 people sitting outside just after midnight, all laughing, carrying on, having a drink. And I thought, this is what it's all about. This is why I do it.
No,
It's worth it.
Well, that was, I mean, obviously, like I said in the intro, the last one, 2021, because obviously, so you missed 2020.
2020.
That was really important for a lot of people.
Yeah. And it's obviously there was a few more hurdles put in place because of what's been going on. But thankfully, everything just went to plan. And so many people were just saying that they missed it so much. And I think it's just given them the hunger back. And they're already itching for this year's in August.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly, I think it was just people got to appreciate what they'd lost, really, didn't they? I think, that was just symbolic in the pinball thing, but no one had really been anywhere for whatever it had been, a year and a half or whatever the case may be at that point. So I think it was really, really important. I also felt two things with it. It was really good how the masks had just been ditched beforehand. Mm-hmm. Someone that wears glasses, I was very, very pleased about that, because I still haven't worked out a technique. And you're spending a long time there if you're there a weekend, which I would advise everybody to do. Mm-hmm. So that was good. The other thing I noticed was when we went home and then looking at the forum for the next week or 2 weeks, there wasn't a load of people on thread saying, I've got COVID now, I picked up COVID. That there was nothing. You seemed to manage it perfectly. Well, there was no little mini pinball community spike in COVID, if you know what I mean.
No, that was, I think it's just down to the hard work and how careful everybody was with cleanliness at the event. The staff regularly cleaning the machines.
Yep.
And I think people just were conscious of the hygiene.
Absolutely.
I never heard of One Kiss, which is good.
No, I mean, it's absolutely brilliant. So just tell us about all the help you get and people. An awful lot of goodwill, obviously, towards what you're doing.
Well, this is it. Nobody gets paid. I don't get paid. The event breaks even. So we could probably start with the lads who are probably the unsung heroes are the mechanics who have the heads under the bonnets of the machines from 9 o'clock in the morning to the last ball being flipped midnight of the session. So you've got Chris, who's Poybug on the forum.
Yeah.
There's Darren, who is Replicas. There is Dave, I can't remember his name on the forum, and Simon. They're the four main guys who regularly maintain the machines, and they just never stop. They just keep the machines going, keep the event going. And my friends and family are there staffing the event, cleaning machines. You've got the electrician, Pete, with his wife, Helen, and the son. They were actually working before I got there this last year at the last event. I turned up at 1 o'clock and they'd already unloaded all the equipment and was setting up the electronics in the hall. It's the enthusiasm. It's immense. And then I've got my friends and family just staffing throughout the entire weekend.
Well, that sorry to interrupt, carry on.
No, it's just and everyone has a smile on their face. The it's such a hard weekend, but they all love it.
Yeah, I guess yes. Good when you're doing something that you enjoy, and there is a really good vibe about the place. I got there early. Must have been on a Thursday. Was it on a Thursday? Whatever. Thursday or Friday. I got there one. Whenever it was, there was a handful of machines in there when I arrived. It's amazing how much of the cabling was in there. So you've really got to change that hole, haven't you? In terms for it to be able to supply, I guess, power to that many machines. It's a lot of gear you need just to put this event on.
Yeah, exactly. And it's predominantly a pinball show, but then you've got the side events, which is the competitions. So you've got Wayne and Paul, they're setting up all their equipment for the competitions, as well as setting up the machines, making sure they play perfectly. Sean Harvey, he ran the classics competition. Yep. So he's setting up in the side room with his wife. And then you've got Tim, who's sorting out all of his equipment for the streaming, which is such a professional job.
He's got a lot of stuff, hasn't he, Tim? He's got a lot of gear. Yeah.
And it's at this stage I'm terrified in case I've missed anybody out. I hate doing this bit because there's so many people help out.
Yeah.
But we need to talk about the people who actually donate the machines as well.
Well, we will get onto that because I want to let people know a lot of information and we'll get onto that bit as well. So we've got, let's just summarize it as much as I say. So you've got, as you say, Sean's there, which is in the side room classics competition. Yep. I didn't know. I didn't register for that. I didn't know so little. It was a real finding out experience for me. I literally found out about what Pinfest was going to be like on this podcast, this whole podcast of Voyage Discovery, as far as I'm concerned anyway, this whole thing. So I didn't know about the classics event. So I didn't register and go in for it. I will do this time. I would encourage everybody to do the same. I don't know the machines. Don't worry about it. Jump in.
Yeah, and we're looking at increasing the prize pot for the classics as well this year.
But still good though. It's still good prizes there.
Yeah, so Sean's working in the background looking for sponsors, that sort of thing, to try and increase the prize pot for that.
Ah, brilliant. Okay. Well, there you go. If you want to donate any prize money or sponsor, I guess you're just open for sponsorship all round, aren't you?
Yeah, that's the thing with it being such a boutique niche hobby. It's difficult to appeal to anyone who's looking to advertise or sponsor.
Okay, well, there you go. We'll put it up there. We'll keep asking. You fancy being one of the sponsors for one of the competitions, classic competition. We're looking for some sponsorship. That would be excellent. I'm going to be going in for that. I think Spencer is certainly indicated that he wants to enter the classics competition.
Where is Spencer? This is the only reason I came on the podcast. I was hoping to meet Spencer.
I know. So I apologize. It's obviously the hurried nature we've had to put this together. He's not here. He actually does have a job. I'm not suggesting you don't. Clearly, you don't. Clearly, you're a busy man.
Yeah, I just sit around doing nothing all day.
So Spencer has a job. But yes, you'll get to see Spencer plenty. Don't worry about that.
Something new this year. Ailsa from Scottish Pinball.
Yes.
They do an immense job because they run the NBA.
Yeah.
Competition where you play off the two machines that hook up together. They drive for hours, bring along a load of pinball machines. But she wants to do more, so she's arranging a women's only competition because. Some of the females, they're a little bit nervous about getting stuck in on the main competition, playing against the men. So he also wants to try and get more women involved. So she's going to run a friendly tournament. And then off the back of that, hopefully, in years to come, starts something great for them and something bigger.
Yeah, no, that would be good. Certainly, and they do an awful lot. Lovely people. Mm. So we've got that. We've got the. Let's just talk about Wayne and Paul, and maybe what they do to put that tournament on, because that's really slick, run really smoothly.
Yeah, again, it's one of these things where they come along and. They probably don't even play any machines because they're setting up the day before, sorting out the competition software, and then running the competition throughout the entire event, and then even afterwards, like the evening sessions, they're still going through all the scorecards, that sort of thing. So they're just working constantly.
It's amazing, amazing job that they did. I can assure you, Wayne did. Play a game because he's the top scorer on my Deadpool is still from Wayne set on there. So I can assure you I've attempted to erase that a few times. I can assure you, but
he had a sneaky game.
I asked him to be fair. I did ask him to.
I'll pull him up
about an hour later. Right, like, come on, mate. You know, so you know,
you've got a job to go to.
Yeah, he's absolutely. Absolutely, yeah. I said you could play, but not that well. I was really amazed at that. I thought I loved the way the scores were collated, the way you could see all the scores on the screen. I thought was fantastic. The rig where you could watch on a big screen if someone was on a game, there would be at least one of them would be on a big screen, so you could have it was like an aerial view of a playfield that someone might be playing on. But that was. Yeah. That was really cool, really professional. And I loved the way it was, particularly on the final day, on the Sunday, when, I don't know, it was down to get down to the last 16, last eight, or whatever the case may be. And the crowds just started to sort of congregate around the roped-off area. Again, it wasn't something I was ever really expecting. And I didn't actually play any pinball that day, I realised, which is strange. Mm. I just was there looking at the scores and looking at what was going on, and it just got really, really tense there, you know. That was brilliant. Of course, we've got the NBA is a very, very good tournament. That's fun. I would advise again anybody to join in on that. I think Jeff was refereeing with his umpire's suit on at one point, which was really good.
That's going to be moved into a side room this year round. Just so, it's just for a better atmosphere. So you actually hear what's going on and the people can chat. So everything's just drowned out with the noise of all the machines. So that'll be in a side room this year. So it should be more fun.
What side room?
There's two other rooms.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So where there's the room where the classics competition was held. Then you've got the big room.
Yes.
And if you keep going further, there's another two rooms.
Oh, brilliant.
So we're going to utilize those two rooms this year.
Oh, excellent. Well, I will do a better job of I'll stick a camera and record a record some of that competition there, because I love that NBA stuff. Well, that was brilliant. And then you've got the stall ball, which is another
very popular.
Yes, big circle around the hall. That's
Neil runs that himself. It's a brilliant addition to the event, and he always has some great prizes.
Yeah, absolutely. And they're right. You know, the prizes are great. And then, of course, you've got the actually, before we get to the games themselves, the venue. Let's have a chat about the venue. So Daventry, was it at, before it was Pinfest, was it at that hotel before?
Yes, there was maybe 3 or 4 of the previous events were held there. It's been held in other locations.
Yeah.
But there's been 3 or 4 held there in the past. So that was a good starting point for me, as everything is under one roof.
Yes.
And it's reasonably cheap, which is what we need. And you just roll out of bed, get something to eat, play a bin ball, drink some beer, and roll into bed.
I thought they were very relaxed as well. Yep. In a lot of those type of venues before, not for, you know, for other conferences that are not pinball related. And
quite relaxed with us.
Yeah, you know, if you need, they're not the type of people, if you walk in with a sandwich from Tesco Express, oh, excuse me, that's not a hotel cuisine, or, you know, they're pretty cool like that, which I think is good.
Yeah, they are good. Plus, we tidied the place up. You wouldn't think there was a pinball event being held there. We leave the venue exactly as we found it.
Yeah, that's nice, and even clear up people's laptops for them.
Yes.
Yeah, it's very, very good. I'm glad. But with that venue, so because this is really important, that you've got to book your rooms for this, because I remember it getting towards the end start of August, maybe. I remember a flurry of activity on the forum and a lot of people saying, oh, we can't get in, we can't get booked in.
This is probably the most frustrating thing about the event, because you can cancel your room 48 hours before you turn up and there's no charge. So if you're unsure, you might be able to make it, you might not. Book your room anyway. You've got 2 days beforehand to cancel it.
Yeah,
and I think it's 30 days before the event, that's when the rooms are released to the general public. So get your room booked.
Yeah, there's no reason. And it is so much better to be at the venue. Anyone I spoke to that wasn't at the venue was disappointed that they couldn't, because even when the hall would shut for the night, which is the main hall with the machines in it, Phil and Chris, basically Pinball Heaven, had put some charity machines in the foyer in the lobby. Mm-hmm. The bar was still open, and there were a number of stragglers, let's say, up until the wee hours, who were, and it was nice. And you wouldn't have been able to do that if you weren't staying at the hotel, or you'd found it more difficult. So not everybody goes to bed at midnight. So and you know, some good conversations, some good chats were had over a beer and a game of pinball up until maybe even 2 o'clock in the morning.
Exactly. Plus the spa facilities have reopened. They were being refurbished, renovated. So we didn't have those last year, but we've got those this year. So even if your partner isn't keen on pinball, there's something for them to do. They'd want to play pinball, they can just have a nice relaxing weekend.
Yeah, I thought it was really good. And loads of parking. I found it really easy to get in and out of as well. I loved it. I mean, it was, you know, don't say that. Not just saying it for the sake of it. It was honestly the highlight of my year. I absolutely loved it. So let's get on to the machines. 150-odd machines in there?
No, it's more 100, 110, I would say.
Okay. But they need to, you're heavily reliant. Obviously, you've got some fire machines behind you and you take some machines up there yourself, but you are heavily dependent on people donating machines, Phil.
Yep, exactly. It's a community event. And if it wasn't for the community donating the Pride and Joy, we wouldn't have an event at all. I don't take any of these machines, but I do have 6 or 7 in the garage which I call my show machines, so that they travel around the country to different events. So I'll take them to NERG. If there's a Play Expo event on at Manchester, I'll take them there. I'll take them up to Scotland for the pinball part of Play Expo, which Colin and Ailsa, Scottish Pinball, organise. So it's not just Pinfest the go-to. So I literally have a collection of show machines as well.
Excellent.
But yes, Colin and Ailsa and Tracy and Chris from Scottish Pinball, yes, they drive down. So it must be about a 6-hour drive for them. So they always bring a Luton full of vans. We have the same people who donate regular to all the events. But even in ones and twos, just to get to see machines that you wouldn't regularly see. I know people are itching to see the donation thread on the forum, so I'll start that soon.
Yes,
it drums up a lot of interest and excitement.
Yeah, it does. And for those of you who don't know, I know most people on here are on the forum, but if you're not, it's pinballinfo.com, isn't it? I think pinballinfo.com, and there's a search bar. It's easy enough. Just type Pinfest in the search bar and click. There's a little box. There's titles only. It will bring up everything you need to know. And but we will go on that in a second. We'll discuss where you need to book, what you need to do. But in terms of the machine donation thread, Phil will create a thread, and it is to donate some machines. And there's no Pinfest without the machine donations. And obviously you've got people that have been donating for years and who you know, and they're going to donate anyway. And I think I've said it before on here, is for people that are maybe a little bit reticent, thinking their machine won't be looked after. It'd be really, really well looked after. I took Deadpool down there last year, which was my pride and joy. I was going to take Elvira. The only reason I didn't take Elvira is I didn't have the armor back yet for it. I'll be taking at least two machines.
Thank you.
I can assure you. I'll be taking at least two machines down there, possibly. Well, I'll have a look on the machine donation thread. I'll probably bring Deadpool down again. If I see there are three other Batmans there, I won't bring Batman. I'll bring something else, but I'll bring two games, certainly.
Even if you can just shove one in the car, if you've got a large car and get a machine in there, you'll get a free ticket for the event. If you bring in a Luton van, the higher costs are paid for, as well as the fuel, and you'll get your free tickets. So, like I say, it's all not for profit, as long as we can make the money back. It pays for itself, the event. It has done. The first year didn't, but every event since then has.
That's great. Are you do you feel that numbers were impacted by COVID, either in a negative or a positive way, were people desperate to get out, or did you feel that numbers might have been a bit down?
The numbers were slightly down. But we actually had people arrive and they were still unsure about attending, so I allowed them to have a wander around, let them make the decision. Some people decided to go for it, some people decided against it.
Yeah, but
the numbers were slightly down.
Okay. Well, I really hope they're up again this year. There's a couple of things. Not that it's got anything to bloody do with me, but I'd love to see 100 people in a tournament. I'd really the main tournament. I'd like to see that. I don't know what the numbers were for the classics, but
it's going to be roughly the same format. I've already spoken to Wayne and Paul.
Sure.
So it is more or less the same. But hopefully we'll get some Europeans over this year, because they missed it last year with the travel restrictions. So hopefully we'll see the European contingent back as well.
I thought of that. Of course, there's travel restrictions there. Yeah, absolutely. So that should be a highly competitive tournament, as it was. But don't be put off that it is all competitive. It's good fun. It's addictively good fun. You might not be as do as badly as you think you might. That's all I'd say. I was expected to be to come last, and I surprised myself, really. I came second from last. So it was great fun, absolutely great fun on that one as well. In terms of the, so obviously people want to book, they need to contact the hotel. The link will be in the description below. When I say that, even if you got, if you're looking at it on a mobile phone, there's a little arrow, click that. There'll be a whole body of information underneath the screen that you're watching this on. Mercure Daventry Hotel. And you've actually arranged, Phil, a discounted price for people attending PinFest, right?
Yeah, that's right. Off the top of my head, I think it's £75 for a double room bed and breakfast each night and £65 for a single each night.
Yeah, absolutely. But you can actually, because I know, because I have booked, if it's just one of you in the room, you can still, what you can do is book a twin. This is a sensible thing to do. If you can book a twin room, if it's just one of you staying in it, they'll charge you the £65. If someone eventually comes to join you, or you get lucky, you never know, and you can hey, what goes at PinFest stays at PinFest. Then you just pay another 10, not to the person, obviously to the hotel. That would be a separate transaction,
yeah,
obviously. So that's that. In terms of buying the tickets themselves, so just booking the hotel is not paying to go to PinFest. How do we get a ticket for PinFest?
You can buy them through Eventbrite, but I know there's like something like a £5 surcharge. But if people contact us, I can reserve tickets for them. But the Eventbrite way, that helps me sleep at night if they buy them that way.
What, you'd like them to be bought via Eventbrite, would you?
Even if they just contact me and say, could you reserve us a ticket? It's peace of mind that I know someone is, that they are going to be there. And it's me that's sort of takes
fronting,
the financial
you're fronting
risk.
The money. Yeah, you're fronting the money.
I take the financial risk, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, but even if you say, reserve me a ticket, you're still relying on them on the day turning up and giving you the money. Okay, so we'll put the link. I don't think I've put the link. Phil, if you could send me the link, I'll put that in the description.
Or you can get everything on the website, ukpinfest.com.
There you go. So that will have a link that directs you to Eventbrite.
Yep, it's got all the hotel booking details on there as well.
There you go. That's the place to go, ukpinfest.com. And obviously the machine donation thread, you'll be... People are badgering you already,
it,
yeah.
Okay. It gets people excited, yeah.
It does, because you see this
list. It fills up the event.
Yeah, it does. It does, because you've already done a thread saying what...
What would you like to see there? Yeah.
What's the best... What are people liking so far? What do they want to see?
I think it was Godzilla. I think that's got the most votes so far. I think it's Godzilla.
Okay. Well, listen, I've got my name down for one. If I've got my name down for Godzilla Premium, if I get it before PinFest, I'll bring it. There you go.
Yeah. There's a lot of people don't know this, but there's one particular user on the forum. He's got a Jetsons. Because they made a one themed on the Jetsons cartoon. Did you know that?
No.
Yeah. I'll not say his name, but he's probably a bit green around the gills right now, because he says it's stored up. I think it's quite high and at the back of all his big collection, but I'd love to see the Jetsons there.
I
don't know if it's a good game. I haven't played it. It's something different to see.
I saw because there's they're always good. We're going to be releasing start of next week Scott's shop log, video shop log. It'll be a really nice little series on the channel of him doing up Dracula, and I've got to say, I've seen a picture of it yesterday and it is coming along really, really nicely. So this is a completely bespoke Dracula. So as long as he can get the playfield over from us, I think even if it doesn't, he's going to look to bring that up. So I think some of these rare machines that people perhaps haven't seen before are really good to have there, aren't they? Because it is an opportunity for people to try stuff.
They're my favourite threads on the forum, actually, the restoration threads. Yeah. There's another user, Nudos. He's done some good restorations in the past. I passed on a right shed of a demolition man. The thread's probably still there, buried in the forum somewhere. But he did a fantastic job bringing that back to life. It was a brilliant job. I'm really jealous as well, because I'm not capable of doing that sort of thing. But some really talented members out there.
There are. I'm actually popping down to see Davey probably next week, actually. Stumblor, who's so I'm going to bring the camera with me, and I'm going to film his creature from the Black Lagoon, which the work he's done on that. You wait till you see the video. Get him to lift up the playfield, and just even the little cable ties are color coded and stuff like that. He's gone. And then I'm going to pop and see, because I bother people. When people do really good stuff, I do message them and say, oh, excuse me, would you mind if I come and have a look? So we've got Ant, who's doing the T2 restoration at the moment, which is ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous level of detail. So I'm going to pop and see him once he's a bit nervous about turning it on eventually. but I'm sure it won't, by the way. So, yeah, some really good restorations being done. So, yeah, if any of those can come down, that's for sure. And I think we're waiting on confirmation for Popeye, aren't we? There seems to be a lot of love for Popeye, I've noticed.
Yes. We'll see when the thread goes up, see if there's one
quite right
being donated.
Yeah, be nice. Someone wants to bring a Popeye along. I'll do a video on it. I'll give it a lot of love. I'll give the Popeye a lot of love. We love Popeye. It's been a long time. Any final words, Phil? Any other information you that we've perhaps not covered that we need to get out there?
No, I think it's about it. I'm going to try and get a guest company to attend the event. I won't mention any in particular, but I will be emailing.
What do you mean a guest company?
A manufacturer, pinball manufacturer.
Oh, okay.
Just email a few and see if we can get somebody to attend just to do a talk.
That'd be brilliant. That'd be real. Well, good luck.
It was planned for 2020, but the event was cancelled. And again, travel restrictions 2021, couldn't do anything there. So hopefully we'll get something this year.
I think it goes a long way with manufacturers if they can speak directly to who their customers are going to be, you know. Really good. Mate, I just think you've done a tremendous job. I really do. And everybody does. There's a lot of, I know you're a modest man.
Yeah, the team behind us, yeah.
I know you do, but there's a lot of goodwill for what you do. And all of you, and your team are well appreciated as well. It is.
Yeah.
It's undoubtedly everybody's the highlight of the pinball calendar. Mate, I look forward to seeing you there.
Great. Thank you. Right. I need to go to the toilet. Absolutely busting there. Budapest is still taking its toll on me.
No, all right. I'll cut it out.
No, you don't have to. Fine. Everyone understands they'll all be in the same boat because we're already talking about the next trip next year, which will probably be Warsaw. Krakow. There's a pinball museum in Krakow.
Oh, is there?
Fingers
crossed you can.
Yeah, we'll get that on the calendar.
Yeah, everything that's going on. Listen, mate, really, really appreciate it. Really do. You know, you're a really good guy. And I won't embarrass him. He sent me a bloody lovely message about a month ago as well. So it was really, very, very much appreciated.
Yeah, keep it up, man.
We will. Don't you worry about that. And even Spencer, I'll dust Spencer off the next time. He will be there at Pinfest. Don't worry. And we'll see you soon. Phil, okay. Thanks so much, mate. Thank you so
Cheers,
much.
Cheers, dude. Thanks.
Cheers, buddy. There you go, Phil. He's off to go to the toilet. I might do the same, actually. I loved speaking to Phil. We'd left it. I wanted to speak to him directly after Pinfest. And then once a certain amount of time elapses, it's actually best to speak to him. When the next Pinfest is coming up. Cannot wait. So please do come along. It's a laugh. I don't want to be telling people to suck eggs and whatnot. And there's a lot of people who went to Pinfest long before I ever went there. But if you haven't been before, if you are a bit of a newbie, if you are considering it, it's brilliant. I tell you, it's better than I thought. It's gonna be pretty damn good. And it was even better than that. There'll be a lot of faces that you recognise there. Even the ones you don't, will stand alongside the bar and have a chat with you. Just going up to people and machines and people that own the machines and talking to them about their machine. A lot of friendly people there. A lot of fun. Very friendly, family-friendly atmosphere as well. Absolutely brilliant. Clearly, I love it. Right, anyway, I'm going to love you and leave you. I'll be back. There'll be a few more videos. We've got Scott's shop log coming up soon. That'll probably be the next thing up here. We've got a video of me trying to play Black Knight, Sword of Rage. No more, probably no more farting in the video. There you go. Keep an eye on the forum, by the way. Keep an eye on that forum for that that thread, the machine donation thread. That's going to be something very, very special. Take care.